applications. As the light that come up with me, some of them.
Hey Ingo, do you know what time it is?
Of course, it's time for 5 minutes with Ingo. So today we are here at the retirement center for data scientists. We have a couple of data scientists around here. They look pretty much like horses in general. And thinking about horses, there is something interesting. Just like human beings, they typically don't all like each other. I mean, they have friends and they have other horses they don't like. So typically they build like groups and different, clusters in within the herd. I hope you say a herd of horses, who knows. Anyway, so we talked about this kind of group building before. In the first season, we talked about k-means clustering, which is a widely used method for actually identifying those natural groups within a data set. But the problem with k-means clustering is you need to know in advance how many clusters, how many segments in your data set are you actually looking for. And sometimes you just don't know that. So there are a couple of ways to figure out for k-means clustering what the optimal point amount of clusters is. But today I would like to discuss a different clustering scheme, a different clustering algorithm. We don't need to define in advance how many groups you're looking for. You basically get all the possible groups and the groups which make sense in one single optimization. Okay, let's have a look here on this whiteboard. So here we see a couple of magnets, and those magnets actually represent our data points in our data space like usual. But instead of thinking about a two-dimensional space, although it's a plain board here, but instead of thinking about the typical two-dimensional space, we have a function up here for the colors of those magnets, defining what of those data points are more similar to each other. So you can see that white data points are more similar to blue data points, and green are equally similar to the red ones. But between those groups, there is less of similarity. So, and of course, red is even less similar to white because it's further away here as well. So that gives an idea what is similar to what to the other data points. So agglomerative clustering is now a mechanism or an algorithm which goes bottom up. So we start basically with the single data points and we start grouping them together. And then we take the groups and group those together again until we finally have basically all data points in one single cluster. So it's a bottom up approach. So let's start with the first data points. Let's, for example, start with those white ones here. So if we start with this data point, we can now think about what is the data point most similar to this one here. Well, obviously, the most similar data point to this white data point is, well, the second white data point over here. So let's take this one here and let's group those two data points together. So they are very similar to each other, and a pen would be really, really nice if a pen could magically appear somehow here. Like now, that would be awesome. Like a black pen. Holy, oh, a pen like this one here. Brilliant. So those two data points we see, they go together. So we can do though the same thing, for example, for those blue ones here. And again, the most similar data point is the other blue one, and they go together again. And then the same mechanism applies for the green ones and the red ones. I mean, of course, if the data points are the same, they are most similar. But even if they're not exactly the same, well, they are, well, differences, more or less differences between the data points. And there will always be a similarity function to calculate this. Okay. So now the next level, we can start thinking about like, well, white is more similar to blue and green is more similar to red. So we basically can group now those data points here together into new groups like this. So now we end up with only two groups on that level here. And then the final step, well, here's least similarity, but still we need to connect them somehow. So let's bring them together here as well. And that actually delivers the data set with all the data points at once. So we start with the single data points, found the most similar ones, and then built the whole, well, tree structure here bottom up. Well, tree structure is a good word here. This whole thing here is also called a dendrogram. And the dendrogram here really shows you all the potential groups in one single picture, which makes it really simple.
So can you talk a little bit more about groups and dendrograms?
Sure. One interesting thing is k-means clustering gives you basically the flat groups like right away. So it tells you like, well, those 5 data points are in one group, those 8 data points are in another group. And dendrograms gives you the full picture, but there is actually an interesting way to get the single groups or the flat groups out of the dendrogram as well. So let's take this one here. It's very easy. If you basically start here at the top and then move this one here down, further down, you basically start here at the top, like, okay, we have one group, and then you just move as a straight line down. So now you see, okay, sure, we have two groups, and so on. And so you see four groups, and then of course all the each data point is its own group. So you basically now go top down for identifying the most likely groups by looking, well, what are the data points close together and where are good cut points. And typically, well, not in this case, but if you look for a real data set with like thousands or millions of data points, it's pretty simple to see where those natural groups then are. And that's for today with 5 Minutes with Ingo. Thank you.
Thank you.